All right. We are now officially streaming live.
Great.
That's what it says.
Well, it's pretty exciting to be here with you, Gene.
I know. I'm excited to be. Well, we're here every Wednesday with each other. So
this I know. Isn't it great? But this week we could actually share it with everyone else and hopefully do something fun with this movie clip.
I hope so as well. It's going to be a blast. So for anybody who doesn't know, this is my good friend, Neil Pretty. Met him through the LinkedIn's, a year ago, maybe 2 years ago now? And we just started chatting. And next thing you know, we kept chatting. And now, like, every Wednesday for, like, the last, like, 6 months, we've been, we have a phone call just to debrief and catch up and kind of are just there for each other as young, vibrant entrepreneurs.
I kind of like doing that. I think it's important in everyone's life to have mentors, have people that are colleagues, and then have people that are mentoring. You know, provides that spectrum of giving and receiving of information and sharing with other people. Yeah. I think it's pretty critical.
Oh, I think so too. The one thing I really like about our relationship is that we're both kind of in that early journeys of both of our things that we're doing right now. So we're kind of in those similar chapters where it's much easier to relate to versus going our mentors who are like many, many chapters ahead of us. And they're going, you can get there. And sometimes you're like, motherfucker, how hard this is? And they're like, yeah, I do. I'm like, but I'm feeling it right now. And then sometimes I'll be like, Neil, I'm feeling this. And he's like, I was there last week and vice versa. That has happened so often.
Well, and then strange things happen, like being asked to be a part of the Vancouver top 100 innovators list. What a strange thing to have come along when you're just chugging along and then somebody says, hey, you realize what you're trying to do is totally different, right? Like actually doing all these things together is not normal. And then, you know, you run into that and wonder, well, I'm just doing what I'm doing and trying to make this make waves out there in the world. It's weird to sometimes have it recognized. So this is a good place to come and debrief on that as well. Like, hey, these wins are coming too. And that's interesting. So,
oh yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think for both of us, like in the summertime, we were like, oh, are we doing the right things? And then like, I think we had that conversation like 2 weeks later, you're like, look at all the wins that I just had. It's just like you and your bucket of wins came along. It's just like, oh yeah, I guess we are, you definitely are doing the right things. So there's probably a lot of people that might not, which is crazy because more people in Kelowna know about you than I probably know about me. Let's tell the pretty world a little bit about yourself and what you're doing, Neil.
I just realized, Gene, that I haven't been recording this.
Yeah. Oh, well, now we're recording.
So now we're recording. So you just asked me a little bit more about myself. So. Yeah. Let's see, where to start. I am sort of a serial entrepreneur. I'm the CEO of a company called Aristotle Performance. We do team and leadership development together in combination with a focus on developing psychological safety. So we understand that 43% of performance is strongly correlated to psychological safety. 200 plus metrics are moved in the right direction by developing that work. So creating better communication, better sense of belonging, inclusion, diversity, more willingness to help each other, better attitude to risk and failure, open conversation, all these things lead to avoiding failures, greater innovation, higher quality of work, massive improvements in performance, or some organizations lower their development time in the pharmaceutical industry, for example, from 5 months or five years, sorry, to 19 months. So it has a huge impact on performance, and people go home happier and less anxious, more satisfied. And there's just this overall win for everyone. So that's what we're up to, that's what we do, and that's a culmination of myself and my business partner and the rest of us that are involved with Aristotle. It's a combination of all of our years of experience coming together to focus in this one area.
Yeah,
and it's been a lot of fun.
Really good. You've definitely you've got a big passion for it. So for people that might not know what psychological safety means, how would you explain that to our moms?
So Have you ever been in a group of people and wanted to say something, but didn't?
Oh, yeah.
That's psychological safety in action. That is your internal, you know, systems gauging the risk, right? We know that it's better to be part of the group than apart from the group. And what we gain from being a part of the group is camaraderie, safety, relationship, all these things that we want as human beings. So it's built into our biology to want to be part of the group. So psychological safety is defined as the how much we're gauging the interpersonal risk. So how easily can we raise our hand and speak up? How easily can we fail in front of the group? How much that is going to affect our ability to speak up really affects people's ability to share ideas, to fail, yeah, to learn, to grow. So that's what it is. That moment that you go, I shouldn't say anything. That is low psychological safety, and that affects team performance more than anything.
That's awesome. That's a great explanation. You know, that's exactly what I was hoping you were going to say about it too. So that's basically you're helping make it a safe place to fail so that people can get to a success quicker. Yeah, and I know you've got tons of stories around that, but.
Yeah. Well, and a lot of people talk about trust and psychological safety is what you receive from the group and trust is what you give back. Right. So people think trust is a two-way street. It's actually not. It's psychological safety one way and trust the other way. Right. So it's a critical thing. We can measure it and track it. And so it takes like 3 minutes.
Yeah. That's awesome. So we wanted to talk about a movie blog. So we talked briefly about this last Wednesday chat. So hit me up with what you're thinking.
Yeah, so what we wanted to do, and Gene, I really appreciate you coming on to do this. We wanted to try something new, something a little bit different. A lot of the conversation around psychological safety is so serious because it's a serious topic. It has serious implications for business. So that's fine. But there's also this other side where sometimes we need to just take things a little less seriously. Sometimes we need to have a little more fun. And we were talking about one movie clip in particular that we thought really exemplified a lot of the things that we talk about in leadership. And we see it in popular movies all the time. And then we go to our offices and see the same caricatures of what we see in movies. And yet it's still how people operate. It's almost the cycle of comical failures that we see in leadership and in teams. And this one movie clip we thought really was a great talking point, and I thought I'd just share it with you and Gene as we go through it. What I'd love, it's only 2 minutes, but yeah. What I'd love is just if something pops in your mind, we'll pause it, talk about it for a minute, and then continue on. And I think that would be a good place to go. So if you'd like to do that, I'll share my screen and we can enjoy a moment of pop culture and talk about it.
All right, let's do it.
Okay, here we go. This is Tom Hanks. One-fifth of the total. Who doesn't love Tom Hanks?
From all of last year. Any questions?
No, not for me.
Yes?
So I love this. I love there's one person with a question. This guy gave his entire pitch. And there's one question.
And he's so eager to ask it too.
Yeah. Yeah, I love it. I love it.
Yes. I don't get it. Exactly. Don't you get it? It turns from a building into a robot, right?
Precisely.
Well, what's fun about that?
If you had read your industry breakdown, you would see that our success in the action figure area has climbed from 27% to 45% in the last 2 years.
I also love how he doesn't even answer the question.
He just backs it up with some facts about here's why you're already triggering me is kind of what I got from him ruffling the papers there.
Absolutely. You've triggered me, and I'd like to communicate to the group that you're an idiot.
Yeah.
You're ignorant. See, here's your ignorance. It's on this paper. This is your way out of being ignorant. Can you please read this?
Yeah.
You know, we see this all the time in teams where people do this in really subtle ways. Oh, well, you know, my favorite is in the email chains. As I wrote below, or as per my previous email, right? You see it all the time. It's everywhere.
I think we've all seen the, like on Facebook or somewhere else, where those are translated into much more, shall we say, descriptive meanings.
Yeah, it's everywhere. And I think that's one of the things we talk about with psychological safety is that how people respond to each other really matters, and it happens all the time. It's these very subtle remarks all the time that people go, I didn't read this report. Oh, I am an idiot. I better not speak up again because I just looked like a fool in front of this group. But what I love about Tom Hanks in the movie Big, he's 13.
Yeah.
So he doesn't know any better.
He hasn't been beaten by that system. But the one thing about where you've paused it right now is just like that look of, it's almost the look of like, well, what the fuck are you talking about? Because I know this isn't fun. And sure. There's like a curiosity peaking in his image right now.
Yeah, but I think the curiosity is focused on, why are you focused on those reports when this toy isn't fun?
Yeah.
Right? And it's like, you missed my question and you're missing the bigger picture here, which is, can you explain how this toy could somehow be more fun, please?
Yeah. Yeah, that might help.
That might help. Oh, sure. Okay.
Got another one.
And you can see it.
I still don't get it.
What?
What don't you get, Josh? Well, there's a million robots that turn into something. And this is a building that turned into a robot. What's fun about playing with a building? That's not any fun.
This is a skyscraper.
Well, couldn't it be like a robot that turns into something like a bug or something?
A bug.
I love this too, because what we often experience on teams is sometimes what we call the politeness breakdown loop, where everybody, you know, you want to be part of the whole. You want the group to be an accepting place where everybody can exist in some sort of cohesive, you know, friendly manner. So people are polite to each other, and then somebody will ask a question and then everybody postures. They kind of go, whoa, what just happened? And I think what's interesting is that there is actually productive inquiry in here. And that takes groups into a more ready state for dialogue.
Yeah.
And what you get in this moment is one person who's saying what aggressively that could shut that down. And a lot of people would look for ways to go back to being polite and nice, and we're talking about the weather. Or you have the CEO in this case, his question is, so what is it? Like, tell me more. Like, I want more information so I can make a better assessment of what's going on. And even though this guy is being a jerk, it actually does take the group to somewhere new, because it's productive inquiry instead of destructive. And we see that a lot with aggressive what and like, why, no, you hear people say that and it shuts things down. So everybody just goes, okay, well, let's not get in trouble. Let's be a group and not get in trouble, and it'll be okay. We can weather this storm together. But good productive inquiry can actually move things along. So I love how there's actually the juxtaposition of both in this clip.
Yeah, like a big prehistoric insect with maybe like giant claws that could pick up a car and crush it like that.
A prehistoric transformer.
Interesting.
Gentlemen.
So the robot turns into a bug.
Gentlemen, listen to it. Just
got a very good idea.
The robot turns into a bug.
This is a great idea.
Someone's a water bug. Josh. Different sizes and things. And
Susan, we could do ladybugs.
You can have them wreck buildings.
Transformers.
A bug.
Go ahead.
The CEO, what the product head doesn't like is like, oh, he's kind of getting through the whole, my idea is being told that it's stupid and that it's dumb and it's wrong, where everyone else is like, well, the CEO's asked the question. Let's start brainstorming now. What else could this be, right? So we already know from the, you know, they know from the facts that kids love Transformers. Big shock. I still love Transformers. Mm-hmm. And so now it's just like, well, a building's boring, but I could play with a robot or a cool prehistoric animal. And now they're all into it. And I love this boss's face. He's just like, what else do you got? That's what that face is telling me right there.
Yeah, keep going, right? And you see this with like hub and spoke style conversation. You report, you report, you report, you report. They're totally unproductive. But as soon as you can get a group into this circular, you know, where everybody's just contributing ideas and there's not really a concern about failure. Yeah. It's more a concern about coming up with the best idea together.
Yeah. And it's some of the parts is like everybody coming together can come up with something really awesome versus, well, I've just got the one idea and you've got the one idea and somebody has to be the wrong idea. Whereas you can actually find something that's even better than both those if you work together. That's what I'm taking from that.
I think that's a great point. I mean, our company started with, I mean, it's called Aristotle Performance because we believe the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. But what does it look like? This is what it looks like.
Yeah.
Where nobody's personal stake is higher than the opportunity of the group.
Yeah. All kinds of possibilities.
This doesn't just happen.
I love that. Of course, it doesn't happen. Well done. You know, this is a moment that people remember in their lives.
Yeah. this just says it doesn't happen. Be like, well, of course not, because you haven't allowed it to happen.
That's right.
Like, well, now it has happened. And like, does that his own unconscious shift that he has to go through? Like, that's a belief. You know, you almost, from my perspective now, I feel sorry for the guy going, man, you just had a massive belief shift that you're going to have to like digest for a little bit. And it's it's okay.
He's going to have to call Gene Brunier for some coaching.
I can help him through that. I can totally help him through that.
Yeah, I can help you find joy in the process.
And if he's got a team, I happen to know a guy that just will help you do that for your whole team.
That's right. Well, and I think what's interesting about this is that people think that this is anomalous. Like, this is super rare. Because it often is, because people don't know how to find it. Leaders are often put in position without training to facilitate a dialogue, which is significantly more important than, you know, managing one-to-ones, you know. And it's harder to learn, so people avoid it because it's harder to learn, but it's more important. You get better results out of this kind of engagement with a whole group, and it doesn't have to be anomalous. That can be the norm. Yeah. And that's how teams succeed, when that's the norm. And that's not what we see a lot of, but we're starting to see more and more of it, because in an environment like that, people go home inspired, people go home feeling engaged. You don't have to worry about engagement numbers when people are showing up to meetings that are like that, instead of meetings where everybody stares at each other like this.
You know, they've got their phone out and they're looking down. They're everywhere but engaged, because that's just a status update. And I'm actually just wasting time, so I don't have to be on my phone or I don't have to be doing anything else. I'm getting paid to sit here and do nothing.
Yeah.
And how disengaging is that? Like, what a way, you know, like one of the things I used to talk about in my previous life as a fractional CTO is like how much money was just wasted being unproductive about people that aren't actually like focused on using that time to get ahead, right? And like, you imagine, well, you probably have stats around that, but like, if you're able to reposition all that time to get back to like a proper productivity level, because people enjoy their job, because they like coming into it and they feel like they're committed and everyone's going in that same direction, like you good luck trying to beat that team. You just won't. And they won't even look at you as competition. They'll be like looking at you to harvest ideas, or in a totally different way that you won't recognize. So a standard team that's trying to work from that command and control perspective, where I'm right, the rest of you are wrong, and if you don't like that, well, then you're filling the personal attack down below. Yeah. And they'll get steamrolled time and time again.
Well, that was one of the things we looked at early on when we were looking at metrics of success for Aristotle performance. What are the things that we want to move the dial on? And we started talking about time. If you could get a team of 10 people, if each one of those 10 people saved 20 minutes a day, 5 days a week, it would be like adding an 11th person to the team without recruitment, without salary, without benefits, without any of the expenses that come along with adding an extra person.
Yeah.
That is a significantly large, like a massive increase in productivity.
Oh, yeah.
And with actually a lower amount of anxiety. To do that, you're actually lowering anxiety. You're increasing people's opportunity to go through their year without mental health issues. You're gaining all these other sort of secondary and tertiary benefits. If you just looked at time, you can gain a whole other person on your team. How great is that? You want another person on your team? And that was actually what one of the pitches that we made early on was, do you want another person on your team without having to hire anyone?
Yeah, you get way more out of them, right? Like I've been on teams and I've seen, you know, teams that I've worked with in the past that are like, they're on it and they're just delivering. I've also experienced and watched other teams where they do not, there is no trust and there is no safety and they're all just waiting to get browbeaten for the next time. And they're afraid, like more mistakes come out and they are slow AF, right? Like just in comparison, like they're just super, super slow because there's no drive. And if they go out and try to be a little bit better, well, being better actually means you have to trip and fall a few times. So they've been beaten down to not do that step. So they just stay and they think that they're staying the same. Well, you know, I used to call them like they're the walking dead. Like they're just doing one of these. And it may be a slow one where everyone's like, why aren't we being profitable? Why aren't we doing this? And it can take 5, 6, 10 years, but you're going there. And everybody from the owner all the way to the janitor is going to hate that trip the entire time.
Well, I mean, there's a couple of things that you put your finger on that are interesting. One is team climate. So if you have this really low psychologically safe environment, but it's a very strong climate, what that means is that everybody knows exactly what's expected of them. But everybody, what that is everybody knows that they better not speak up or make mistakes.
Yeah.
So what you see in that is consistent performance. So often organizations will have these teams that are actually low performers, but because they're consistent, they're predictable. And organizations like predictable, they just don't realize that there's this massive opportunity for growth.
Yeah.
It's the teams where you have this really varied experience of what it's like to be on the team that you see inconsistent results. And that's usually where effort goes towards, but there's lots of room for growth. But the other thing that you brought up was actually like mistakes. You know, innovation requires a tolerance for failure. Sometimes it's going to be a 10% failure. Sometimes it's going to be 90% failure. But organizations that are learning organizations that have resilience built into them actually have a tolerance for some failure. So imperfection is not as important as progress, right? But progress is always going to have a little piece that isn't exactly right. So there's this like iteration and you know, constantly adjusting the steering wheel on what's going on. And if you actually go back into Amy Edmondson's work and dig deep into it, and I mean, you really actually don't have to dig that deep. But when she first started looking at medical teams and surgical teams in hospitals, the teams with higher reported mistakes had higher client outcomes. So what gives? What it was those teams were reporting more and learning from their mistakes, whereas the teams were reporting less were just hiding.
Yeah.
So the mistakes were going hidden and people were suffering and dying as a result.
Yeah.
So it is actually the ability to report those mistakes that makes a huge, huge difference in the lives of people on teams, innovation, organizational resilience. I mean, you want to talk about a time of COVID-19, nothing's perfect.
No. So
already have that tolerance to imperfection built, it's people have to build it. And it's really, you know, I laugh when people talk about resilience because I have my own stories around that, but which of course we could probably share in future recordings. But you know, resilience really requires people to go through something that's not perfect and not easy and come out the other side standing tall and being able to learn from that. And I think that and acknowledge their accomplishments. So
yeah.
Anyways, we've been talking a whole bunch, and I think this has been pretty fun and entertaining for me anyways, and a little bit different.
Oh yeah. No, man. Like it's like every Wednesday. I always say, I wish that these calls were recorded when we finally hit the record button on one. So
there's probably too much swearing normally.
Well, I think I was the only one that we have to bleep anything on. So that's all right.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I was a good boy today. You were too. So, and this was really fun. So thanks a lot, Gene.
All right, brother. Well, thanks for being part of the live cast.
Great.
We will talk to you soon. And remember, if anybody's wondering if their team isn't performing good enough, go connect with Neil. His link is in the bio or in the post here, and he's going to be able to help you out through Aristotle Performance to get you consistently performing at a very high level. You got to trust him because he'll bring the safety for you. Ah, there you go. That's a free one.
Nice.